He is risen. Our call to worship this morning is 1 Peter 1, verse 3 and 4.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you. Amen.
Amen. We praise you, Father. We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Holy Spirit. We praise you for welcoming us to this Easter service of joy and thanksgiving, saying, Hallelujah, our Savior lives. He lives indeed. Announcements. Men's and ladies' Bible study this Tuesday. Going to be a little change in that the men's Bible study is going to be downstairs in the new, whatever room we're going to call that. When we come up with a name for the room, we'll figure out what room it is. But anyway, we're going to be meeting downstairs instead of upstairs. The room is all ready. The program is done. So I want to thank Dan for doing that. And I want to also thank Doug and Roger and Al. Oh, I'm getting to Al, yes. He's got his hand up like this.
Yeah.
And Al for all the work that they did in there to get that room done. It is truly, truly a marvelous work that you have done. Thank you very much to all of you. And I think you all deserve a big round of applause. Our next congregational business meeting will be April the 21st. Please have reports to me by April the 10th. Bereavement Support Group meets Wednesday, April the 3rd. That'll be this coming Wednesday at 1:30 to 3. And we'll continue until May 22nd. And it's for free, and it's held at St. Peter's Lutheran Church. There is a poster downstairs. Hike for Hospice will be held June 2nd. More details to come. Don't forget to save stamps and other religious articles, books, Bibles, and so on and so forth for ones that we send to missions. Birthdays? Yes. Number of birthdays listed in your bulletin. The most important one, according to Annika, is her birthday, which will be this week. So happy birthday to all of you, and we are going to sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. May the Lord bless and keep you. Happy birthday to you.
And many more.
Also of note, the office is no longer downstairs. The office has been moved into the prayer room, so now it is the prayer and office room. So it is not downstairs, that is now designated for storage. So thank you to Dan and Shannon and Bob for moving those things around. Oh, I'm Bob, yes, for moving those things around on Friday. But yes, it'll make a big difference to those who are counting and also for how much we can clean up downstairs. See, we lost a lot of storage room with doing the, whatever that room is called, making it into a good room. Next week, we are going to celebrate Lord's Supper. This past week, I, along with Dan and Shannon, Doug and Nancy, had the opportunity of participating in a Passover Seder at Calvary Church, Calvary Mission Church in Owen Sound. I want to thank Nancy for arranging this. It was a blessing to be part of this supper, which has taken place for over 3,000 years and was now shown in the view of our Christianity. We ate unleavened bread, drank from the cup four times, following the tradition set out by the Jews in Moses' day. We got to wash our hands twice. We praise God, the King of the universe, for choosing us out of all the people of the earth, making us holy through his word and loving us. But commanding us to follow his commands, rejoicing in his command that he gave us all this freedom. Jesus commanded us that on Monday to Thursday to participate in the Lord's Supper. This participation must be done in reverence and honor to his holy name, and not as a side item to our monthly First Sunday worship service. If we expect God to bless us, we have to bow in humbleness before him and come with hearts seeking repentance at his table next Sunday. God will be with you. May God be with you as you prepare to enter his presence next Sunday to sit at his table. Come anticipating to meet God at his table that he has set specifically for you. This time it's my privilege to lead you in our prayer of invocation, and I stop partway through that prayer for a time of personal silent prayer. Shall we pray? Rejoice, rejoice, you gathered here at Frank Street, and those watching us on the video, lift up your hands and hearts, souls and spirits to sing praises, glory, and honor to our Redeemer King. Hallelujah. Jesus, our Savior, rose victorious over sin and death and hell to deliver us as washed white as snow to our Father and his Father. Oh, our hearts burst with glad tidings at Satan's ultimate defeat on that Friday. This morning we come singing and rejoicing, praying and being attentive to your message, the dawning of a new day, a day filled with sunshine and gladness. A day of looking forward to heaven's gates that will be wide open for each of us at our appointed time. A new day when all the host of heaven shout with praises as we sing hallelujah, victory in Jesus. In this joyous occasion, let us stop for a time of personal silent praise. With hearts to heaven and voices raised, we sing our hymns of praise, looking forward to our day of resurrection with you standing with your arms wide open to welcome us, drawing into a new day, a day that will last for all eternity. What an awesome God we serve, all powerful, all wise, full of mercy, grace and love, forgiving, righteous, almighty, all-knowing. We bow in humble gratitude before your mercy seat. We pray all of this through the love of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first song this morning is number 365, Alleluia, Alleluia. And we ask you to stand as you are able. Father, we marvel at the wonder of it all. the way you look after the daily need for all of us, giving us homes, food, and clothing. We offer praise to you through this offering, and we count our blessings one by one. Our prayer of thanksgiving for all that you have given us, we offer to you now. We bow in praise to your gracious hand of love. We pray through the power of the Holy Spirit and in Jesus' precious name. Amen. The responsive reading is in your bulletins and will also be on the overhead. And I'd like to lead you in the responsive reading at this time. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous.
The Lord's right hand has done mighty things.
The Lord's right hand is lifted high.
The Lord's right hand has done mighty things.
I will not die, but live. Open for me the gates of righteousness.
I will enter and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter.
I will give thanks for your goodness to me. You have come in salvation.
The stone the builders rejected
has become the cornerstone.
The Lord has done this.
And is marvelous in our eyes.
The Lord has done this, done it this very day. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Amen. Number 367, Christ the Lord is risen today. We ask you to stand as you are able. Shannon, come forward.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Well, it is great to have everyone here, and we are glad to have you here. And this morning's seniors moment, actually my sister Heather gave me these cards, and I'm glad I remembered them today. And I'm going to ask Bob to hand one out to everyone at whatever point, it doesn't matter, beginning or end or in between. We have a picture for you to look at today. And it looks like a brand new car. And I even went in close on it last night and I couldn't see any dust on it or anything. It's a shiny, it looks like it's shiny and clean. It looks like this person owns it, has it all together. I'm going to say it's a woman that owns it because there's a Hello Kitty frame around the license plate. That's my guess. But when you look a little closer, what do you see? Yeah. Yes, Emily, exactly. It's the bumper stickers that caught our attention. They are bumper stickers that say on the bottom left there, Godless. And on this corner here in the fish is the word heathen. Yeah. Even using the Christian fish symbol to say heathen. Mocking. I took it as a mock of our faith. Where do you think this picture came from? Somewhere off the internet, perhaps? No, I took this picture in a parking lot in Hanover. Dan and I could not believe our eyes. So I took a picture, and I didn't know if the owner would be running out to accost me or... That didn't happen, but I took this picture in a parking lot in Hanover. And as I say, we were shocked to see such a flagrant denial of God. But that's why the owner of that car and sinners like you and me, that's why Jesus had to die. And die in such a cruel way, enduring the wrath of God. Because we, if you are a believer, we were godless heathen. You see, at the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And that's from Romans chapter 5, verses 6 and 7. In the book of Job, we read, "Can papyrus grow tall where there is no marsh? Can reeds thrive without water? While still growing and uncut, they wither more quickly than grass. Such is the destiny of all who forget God. So perishes the hope of the godless. What they trust in is fragile. What they rely on is a spider's web. They lean on the web, but it gives way. They cling to it, but it does not hold." And from Romans chapter 1, final verses I'd like to share with you. "The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God, nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like a mortal human being and birds and animals and reptiles. That's why it's so important for us to share with others what God has done for us. We need to educate them. We need to witness to them. We need to walk alongside godless and heathen people, and we need to pray for them. Let's do that right now. Gracious and loving God, we pray for all those around the world who do not know you yet and have no one praying for them. Knowing that you work in ways that we cannot understand, we ask that our prayers might lead them to you. We ask your Holy Spirit to descend upon them and give them the wisdom to look for you. In you, God, every question finds an answer, and every longing of our hearts is fulfilled. Even when we believe we desire something else, deep down what we truly long for is you, God. Help each one of us to serve as living examples of your redemption, your love, and your power. Help us to reflect your light and truth so that we would make disciples in your name, baptizing them and teaching them according to your word and to your glory. In the name of Jesus, our risen Savior, we pray. Amen.
You very nicely recapped what we were taking in men's Bible study on Romans, and we've been at it for how many weeks now? It started in January. But, we haven't finished the first chapter yet. We're getting there, though. But it's an excellent study, so I encourage all men to come. Right, Al?
That's right.
Yep. Does anybody have any items to add of thanksgiving or praise or prayer requests? Yes.
Still praying for the hostages.
I've got them in here.
I knew you would.
Yes.
Praise for 49 years marriage.
49 years. I don't know why she's put up with you.
It's worth the praise.
I know, but in good Dutch, you know, we're stubborn and we go through it all, right? Yep. Shall we pray? Oh, what a glorious day when we were redeemed, sanctified, born again over 2,000 years ago, a day we celebrate each year, a day that dawns like no other through all of history, a day of great rejoicing in heaven and on earth. Our Savior defeated death and gives us new life. The next song we will be singing says, "Were you there?" The answer is a resounding yes, because our Savior raised all of us from the hand of eternal judgment and rose, and so we can go to heaven and to heavenly glory with him when he rose from the grave. The joy of it all is beyond our understanding and comprehension, as to how and why. Therefore, we just receive and believe the free message of salvation. Lord, we look forward to a joyful time, to our joyful times, the joyful times that we spend with you. But also in Luke 15, verse 7 says, in the Passion Translation, in the same way, there will be glorious celebration in heaven over the rescue of one lost sinner who repents and comes back home and returns to the fold. Instill in us the need to get heaven celebrating continuously as we bring neighbors, loved ones, and friends to a wonderful saving knowledge of Jesus, our marvelous Savior, and what a glorious opportunity has been given to each and every one of us. We live in a world full of uncertainty, natural calamities, and war. But in and through it all, we rest in the fact that this is your world. You created it, and nothing happens without your knowledge. We cannot make sense of it all, but we rest in the assurance that you work for the good of those that truly love you and wholeheartedly worship you as Lord of their lives. We pray for the peace of this world. We pray for the release of hostages worldwide in all situations, for the end of genocide of religious and ethnic reasons. We pray for the end of religious persecution. We pray for all missionaries and pastors proclaiming the good news of the new day dawning. We pray for those in our families and friends in need of your healing touch or for comfort from the loss of loved ones. And therefore, Lord, we remember Tanya's family. Be with them as her day of passing comes up. We pray for Liv, for Henry, for Luke, for Carlos, for Mary Wynn, for Mary Lou, for Ruth, for Murray, and any others that we know, and also those with mental and physical disabilities, those harboring grudges or feelings of disrespect, for world leaders, for families that are in disputes and hurting, for the lonely and depressed. So many needs, but only one solution: to love you, and you will give us strength, comfort, and a way to deal with whatever life sends us. What grace we find in you and your word when we read and meditate on it daily, when we internalize it and make it part of our day-to-day living as much as breathing. You are a multifaceted God looking after all that you have created. As I read this week, the astronomers have found another solar system they didn't know existed, and they say it is larger than ours. Your handiwork is just what we know is just the tip of the iceberg of all that you have created, Lord. In your grace, hear our prayer of praise and supplication. As we leave here singing, He lives, and He walks with me and talks with me along all of life's way. Hallelujah. What a God we love and serve. May today and every day see us rejoicing in the love of our risen Savior. We pray in His name. Amen. I now invite Pastor Shannon back to the pulpit. Oh, I got to sing, yes. Sorry, forgot. Got to sing. Number 315, where are you there? We just added this about a month ago, and I'm a little slow in catching up. I should stand as you're able. Where are you there? The four verses.
Oh,
Think on these things as you hear the word of God taken from the book of Matthew. And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting there opposite the tomb. The next day, the one after preparation day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I will rise again.' So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first." "Take a guard," Pilate answered. "Go make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. After the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He's not here, he is risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Amen. May God be glorified because we have heard his truth. Let us pray. Father, we come before you this morning humbled by the depth and breadth of the love that you have for us. And we come gladly before you this morning as we celebrate the emptiness of your tomb. Help us to see and hear you and accept in faith what you reveal to us, so that our joy may be full and so that we would serve you faithfully, trusting in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. It was a beautiful Easter Sunday, morning, and the church was gathered on a country hillside to celebrate the sunrise service. As the first light of dawn broke over the horizon, the congregation joined together in singing hymns of praise. However, as they sang, something unexpected happened. From the nearby farm, a rooster began to crow, its loud cries echoing across the hillside. At first, the congregation was taken aback by the interruption. But then, as they listened to the rooster's unwavering song, they couldn't help but smile. At that moment, they began to realize the significance of the rooster's Easter morning crow. Just as the rooster heralded the dawn of a new day, so too did Jesus' resurrection usher in a new era of hope and redemption for all humanity. For according to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. As the sun continued to rise, the congregation joined together in a chorus of praise, grateful for the reminder that Easter was about more than just beautiful sunrises and hymns of praise. It was a celebration of the new life and hope found in Jesus Christ. And as true and as joyous and uplifting as that is, that new life and hope are found in Jesus Christ because he is the promised risen Messiah who clothes us in garments of salvation and covers us with the robe of righteousness when we believe in him. And as much as the crowing rooster heralds the beginning of a new day, the crowing rooster reminds me of another truth. Before Jesus was crucified on the cross, he warned Peter, one of his disciples, saying, "Truly I tell you, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times." And that is just what happened. When recognized as having been seen with Jesus of Galilee, Peter disowned Jesus three times, at first saying, "I don't know what you're talking about." He denied knowing Jesus a second time with an oath, stating, "I don't know the man." Then he began to call down curses, and he swore to them, "I don't know the man." That's what he said when he was challenged a third time as being a follower of Jesus. Scripture tells us that after Peter's third denial of knowing Jesus, immediately a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken. "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times." And Peter went outside and wept bitterly. So as heartwarming as it was to hear the congregation charmed by the rooster's heralding of a new day, to me it begs the question, are you singing the praises of Jesus in the light of the sun, or are your ears tuned to the rooster as you continue to deny who Jesus is and what he's done for you? Each one of us has a choice as to whether we see the risen Christ as the dawning of a new day or whether we deny him. My question to you this morning, on this morning when we are celebrating Jesus, our risen Savior, are you standing rejoicing in the light of the dawning of a new day, brought on by the life, death, and resurrection of the Son of God. Do you know what it is to stand at the foot of the cross, assured of your righteousness before God, because you believe in Jesus, the name of hope? Or does the crowing rooster at the dawn of a new day still ring in your ears, reminding you of your denial of Jesus, the risen Savior? Easter reminds us that Jesus' resurrection brings new life and hope to all who believe in him. These last few weeks here, we have focused upon the signs God gave the world as his Son, his holy and divine, the sinless and sacrificial shepherd of his people, Jesus, hung upon the cross of Calvary and died there. For 3 hours, the light of the sun was blocked, so the darkness not only enveloped Jesus as he suffered, but covered the entire land. It defied the laws of nature because our Heavenly Father made it happen. We marveled at the wonder of the 4-inch-thick, 30-feet-tall, twisted linen veil guarding the Holy of Holies being torn from top to bottom when Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and gave up his spirit. We saw how even creation itself groaned and trembled, the rocks even split at his death. Today's reading from the Good News of Matthew describes how a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus, going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. The religious leaders of the day unwittingly fulfilled the purpose of God by taking extreme security measures at the gravesite. They denied Jesus' deity, his status as the Son of God. Funny enough, they remembered what Jesus had said. They remembered Jesus' words saying, "We remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I will rise again.'" They denied the truth of Jesus' word, and they denied his deity and called him that deceiver. They denied Jesus' identity and suspected that his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. Concluding that this last deception will be worse than the first, the religious hierarchy wanted to make sure that the tomb remained sealed. They did not want to see the emptiness left behind by a risen Savior. They did not want there to be any chance or possibility that Jesus would rise from the dead the way he said he would. And they certainly did not want to witness that emptiness. They denied Jesus' power by following Pilate's orders to take a guard, go make the tomb as secure as you know how. According to the Greek and Roman antiquities, one Roman guard consisted of 4 men that rotated throughout the night. So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. In doing so, they denied that Jesus was who he said he was. By sealing the stone and posting a guard, they denied that Jesus could overpower them. The seal was a soft, malleable substance, probably clay or wax, that was imprinted with the Roman imperial seal and attached to the stone with a rope. Breaking the seal would incur the emperor's wrath if someone could first get past the guards. French priest and historian E. Locamus stated, "Never had a criminal given so much worry after his execution. Above all, never had a crucified man had the honor of being guarded by a squad of soldiers." Everything in human power and policy was done to prevent a resurrection. So stone and clay and wax and rope and man were considered enough to overpower the truth of Jesus' deity, his identity, and his power. We see the same thing happen today. We pad our lives with things that are meant to protect us, to seal our comfort and future. Like the parable of the rich fool who tells himself, "You have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry." But God said to him, "You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself?" This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves but is not rich toward God. In their paranoia, the religious and political authorities of Jesus' day used everything they had to try to keep Jesus dead, in the tomb and out of sight. But what happened next? God's word tells us that there was a violent earthquake. "For an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were as white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men." So much for the power and ferocity of the most feared Roman guards and their rope and the Roman seal and the wax. Before these big, burly guards shook and became like dead men, they experienced a violent earthquake. They saw an angel of the Lord come down from heaven, roll back the stone, and sit on it. They probably had to shield their eyes, for the angel's appearance was like lightning and his clothes as white as snow. As it says in the New Testament book of Romans, "For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse." Lately, that's one of my favorite verses. These Roman soldiers, these Roman guards were without excuse. They saw a glimpse of the power and glory of God. But what do they do? What do they say in order to preserve their lives? Do they say someone broke the seal? Who, if they did and had no one to point to, the soldiers would be punished to death? Do they say they broke the seal, a crime punishable by death? Do they lie and say they fell asleep, also punishable by death? Or do they say Jesus rose from the dead, but that would be blasphemy, which we know is punishable by death as Jesus experienced. The Bible says that some of the guards came rushing into the city to the chief priests and told them everything that had happened. Even small and seemingly simple words like some, we need to notice those words, because the Bible says some of the guards went running to the chief priests and told them everything that had happened. They felt the violent earthquake. They saw the angel roll back the stone and sit on it in all his brilliant light. Did they hear the angel tell the women that Jesus has risen just as he said? That he has risen from the dead and is going ahead into Galilee where they will see him again? Did they see the women fall at Jesus' resurrected body and worship him? Did they hear Jesus speak? The Bible says some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. The chief priests gave a large sum of money to the soldiers to falsely accuse the disciples of stealing the body. And some of the soldiers took the money. Some of them accepted payment to deny what they had seen accomplished by the power of God. Some of those guards did not take the money, and Lord willing, they too joined a growing body of believers. The question is, are you denying Jesus Christ? Or are you this day welcoming the dawning of a new day that faith in Jesus brings to all who trust in him as the Son of God who lived, died, and rose from the dead to reign in heaven forevermore? May God have mercy upon each one of us, that we would be numbered as his saints until he comes again. Let us pray. Lord God, Son, and Holy Spirit, you knew and you know that we need you. In your great mercy, motivated by love, you sent and submitted to sacrificing yourself for our guilt, our wrongdoing, and wrong thinking. Praise and glory and thanksgiving forever and ever be offered to you, Father, Son, and Spirit. Nothing will overpower your will or your kingdom. We thank you, Lord, that you have given us eyes of faith and hearts that trust in you. For you are the way, the truth, and the life. Most worthy, almighty Creator, as we celebrate the dawn of a new day of hope that trusting in Jesus, our risen Savior, brings, we lift up before you our children, their spouses, and their children. We lift up our families and friends, our enemies, and all those who do not believe in you, so that you would have mercy upon them and grant them faith in you, that you would write their names in your book of life, that they would deny you no longer, but come to know the peace of your presence as they trust in you, Jesus, as their risen Redeemer. In his powerful name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Mary Wynn, for the music today. We have much to sing about. Our final hymn is number 368, He Lives. Please stand as you're able.
I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever they may say. see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to him all.
Sunday. And I wanted to thank Lori and Lisa and Mary Jane for decorating for today. It looks lovely. I'd like to close with a benediction. And this is written by Janine Sletum. Go forth with renewed hope, trusting in the transforming love of God. God does not leave things as they are. With God, all things are made new. All creation responds to God's presence. The world is alive with possibility. We open ourselves to this truth. With Christ, we trust our whole lives to this power. Nothing is beyond the reach of God, neither evil nor hardship nor death. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Let us leave this place like we believe it. Amen.